today, a special, special show. What a better way to commemorate our 50th show than to do it as a tribute to Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. And for Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar tribute on the 50th show, which we are calling it as Babasaheb Ambedkar birth anniversary, we are calling it as Omnitude Day. And this can be loosely translated to Ekatmata Divas. It is the day of bringing people together and using our dharma for uniting people rather than dividing people. And so that I think is a great tribute that we can pay to a great leader who not just broke all the social barriers, got out of his extremely challenging life difficulties, brought himself up and fought for all the people who were suffering throughout past who knows how many years, millennia people are suffering. He brought them out and he brought about the change. But not only that, he also was the primary author or chair of the committee that wrote Indian Constitution. So enormous contributions to India, enormous contribution to Hindu dharma, to the Hindu community, and a tremendous contribution to the history of Hindus, and tremendous contribution in bringing about the changes of the lives of generations to come, not the generations that preceded. And I would say that I will go over a full biography of Dr. Ambedkar, but I want to turn it over to you to welcome everyone and to introduce our special guests.
Thank you, Ajay Bhai. And my apologies. I had gone through about 10 minutes of introduction in the beginning and nobody heard me. So now I have to say it again. And I am honored to say it again because the two people who I am going to introduce today are scholars and activists and people of knowledge in their own right. And so today we have Advocate Vinod Divakar, who is the additional Advocate General for the state of Uttar Pradesh, the largest state in the Union of India. And he's also an expert on the history of Dr. Ambedkar's life, as well as his impact on the society. And he's a lawyer with the Supreme Court of India. So welcome, Dr. Vinod Divakarji. And we also have with us Priya Saha, who is the Executive Director of Human Rights Congress for Bangladesh Minorities, and the publisher of Dalit Kantha or Dalit Voice, Kantha as Sanskrit word, Bengali word, voice. And Priya Saha has been a voice for the minorities of the Bangladesh, formerly East Pakistan. And she has worked very hard all her life to protect and promote the cause of the Hindu community in that country. And in the recent past, over the last 3 years, she has gone through tremendous troubles and struggles because of the threat to life she has been facing from different radical groups in Bangladesh, and she's currently in Washington, D.C. So thank you, Priyadi, for joining us and for bringing your perspectives from the Bangladesh angle, from the non-Indian angle on this day of Omnitude. So welcome to the show, and Ajay Bhai, back to you, and you can start.
So that I want to just take a couple of minutes for people who are joining us who have not had privilege of knowing the biography of, because a lot of people were born and brought up in America and they may not know the biography of Dr. Ambedkar. Let me just quickly go over the life story of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar. For people in India who know where Madhya Pradesh is, it's a central part of India. And Dr. Ambedkar was born in Madhya Pradesh, in Mau, which is now officially known as Dr. Ambedkar Nagar. He was born in 1891, and his official birthday was 14th of April, 1891. We are celebrating just about a few days late. He was educated in a school in his local town because his father was in the military. And so there's some heart-wrenching stories about his childhood that everyone should learn from and make sure that these kinds of things nobody ever goes through in life again. He was, even though he was allowed to go to school, but he was not allowed to touch water or the jug of water. And he had to, in a somewhat segregated way, he was being seated in the class. And with very little help from his teachers, he still was able to bring himself up through his brilliance, through his hard work. And once he was able to do that, then he went to the Elphiston College in Mumbai for his higher education. And similar life experiences at Elphiston College as well. But he was the first of the Mahar caste that he belonged to, or Jati, we would call it, in a real Indian context, because the caste itself is a foreign word. The concept of caste really does not exist in Hindu Dharma. So he belonged to a Jati from Mahar, and he was the first Mahar to actually graduate from Elphiston College and from Mumbai University. Following that, he got a scholarship from Baroda University, from Maharaji Sayaji Rao of Vadodara in Gujarat, and he was able to go to Columbia University at the age of 22. And he was he graduated from Columbia University. He did quite a bit of work. He got his master's degree over there. He presented a paper, Caste in India, Their Mechanisms, Genesis and Development. And he was able, and his thesis actually was on philosophy, history, sociology, history, philosophy, and anthropology. And the thesis was Ancient Indian Commerce. And he was influenced by John Dewey and his work on democracy. Now, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar was also, he also enrolled in the London School of Economics, where he started working on his doctoral thesis. And eventually, there's a long story about how his thesis, he returned to India, he sent the thesis to London, and the boat that the thesis was traveling actually was torpedoed by the Germans, and he had to resend the thesis, and it delayed his graduation. But he did get two PhDs, one from Columbia and one from London School of Economics. He was also a lawyer who was admitted to the bar at the University of, at the, in the Gray's Inn, which is University of London. Dr. Ambedkar was very active. Once he graduated, he became active in the untouchability movement in Bharat. And he spent many years in trying to make sure that the temples are opened up to everyone. And he did quite a few satyagrahas to open up the mandirs. And when it comes to his political career, he advocated for equality and for voting rights. He was the one to use the word depressed classes to denote the untouchables among Hindus, who were later, he named them the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes under the India Act of 1935, and then in the Indian Constitution of 1950. He made sure that they were the classes, the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes were represented in the legislative bodies in India prior to Indian independence and after the independence. And when India became independent, he was, he obviously was, as I said earlier, he was appointed the chair of the committee that wrote the Indian Constitution. And he was also awarded eventually the highest honor that Indian government gives to a civilian called Bharat Ratna. So this is the life story. And I obviously am trying to summarize in less than 5 minutes. I'm omitting a lot of things, but really this is a life story and a lot more as will come out as we discuss his life and his work. But essentially this is the life story of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, in whose memory today we are calling this day the Omnitude Day. Utsada, over to you to start the conversation with our guests.
Yes, thank you, Ajay. And I wanted to invite Vinodji, because Vinodji, you know, our knowledge on Baba Saheb Ramji Ambedkar is based on our little understanding of what he did. But Vinodji has a much deeper understanding, a much deeper analysis of both his worldview as well as his education and his early life. So Vinodji, please take over and educate us on Dr. Ambedkar's worldview.
Thank you. First of all, I will pay my sincere tribute to the principal architect of modern India, Baba Saheb Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar, on his 130th birth anniversary. Madam Priya Saha, Executive Director of Human Rights Congress for Bangladesh Minorities and publisher of Dalit Voice. Mr. Ajay Saha, the convener of the program. Mr. Utsav Chakravarti, the host of the program, and friends. Namaste and greetings to everybody. I'm happy to join you today on celebrating the 130th birth anniversary of modern architect of India, Bharat Ratna Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. Friends, let me tell you, nothing is more powerful than the power of words, especially if the words come from someone we admire and look up to. We meet, watch, hear many leaders every day. Some we agree with and some we don't. But there are those who leave a great impact on the lives of millions of people around them. They change the fate of the country. They bring a change that once looked like a dream. Friends, we all know I'm talking about everyone's Baba Saheb, yours, mine, and everyone who truly believes in the constitutional morality and India's emergence as world's largest vibrant democracy. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar is not just an icon of democratic politics. He's also a folk icon. Post-independence India has seen the emergence of Baba Saheb Ambedkar on one of the most powerful icons of democratic politics because of writings and his vision for Ek Bharat, Shrestha Bharat. India and Indians breathe and enjoy our glorious cultural diversity, because of our federalist structure Indian constitution. As I look around in India, I see the crumbling reins of the cruel caste system like a heap of futility. And yet, I shall not commit the grievous sin of losing faith in our constitution, which ensures liberty, equality, and fraternity to all citizens, irrespective of caste, creed, and religion. Dr. Ambedkar said, "I like the religion that teaches liberty, equality, and fraternity." Today, we are celebrating the birth anniversary of a man who has given so much to the world and fought. Just a minute.
Please continue.
Yes. Yes. I'm sorry. Today, we are celebrating the birth anniversary of a man who has given so much to the world and fought for the rights of the marginalized section of society. Therefore, I'm offering a brief introduction to his work. The sixth Indian who received prestigious Nobel Prize for Economics, Professor Amrita Sen, has acknowledged Dr. Ambedkar, his father of economics. Dr. Ambedkar was the labor member in the Viceroy's Executive Council between 1992 to 1946. And during this time, he has framed various legislation for the benefit of women, labor, and citizens of India. Equal rights to women in the property and marriage were introduced through Hindu court bill. The bill dropped in parliament. Dr. Ambedkar resigned from the Nehru's cabinet because of Hindu court bill could not pass. Finally, the Supreme Court of India has acknowledged and the women's are given their rights in ancestral property and marriage. Dr. Ambedkar refused to draft Article 370 of the Constitution, which gives special status to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now this article has been repealed by the Parliament of India. We are thankful to this government because it was discriminatory and against the principles of unity and integrity of nation. Article 370 was eventually drafted by Gopala Swami Iyengar, former Diwan of Maharaja Hari Singh of Jammu and Kashmir. Maternity Benefit Act, was enacted for the welfare of women engaged in factories. It provides women labor welfare fund, maternity benefit for women labor, restoration of the ban on employment of underground works in coal mines. Women and Child Labor Protection Act was enacted by him. Equal pay for equal work, irrespective of sex. Later, it was embodied in the Article 39D of the Indian Constitution. The source of reference for all Financial Commission of India is the doctoral work of Dr. Ambedkar thesis titled The Evaluation of Provincial Finance in British India in 1923. All Indians should have the right to vote without bias in gender, caste, or class, liberty or religious on basis of universal adulthood franchise. He voiced before South Borough Commission, the commission constituted for enacting Government of India Act 1990 and later on before Simon Commission. The Reserve Bank of India was conceptualized on the guidelines presented by Dr. Ambedkar before Hilton Young Commission in 1925. His PhD thesis, The Problem of Rupees, Its Origin and Its Solution, was reference tool and guidance for the RBI Act 1934. Dr. Ambedkar's book, Thought on the Linguistic States, was written in 1955. Dr. Ambedkar had recommended to the State Reorganization Commission in 1955 for the division of Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Maharashtra, and Uttar Pradesh. Further, he envisaged the division of Uttar Pradesh into three states, Western, Central, Eastern. Bihar split into two, with Patna and Ranchi as capital. Of course, we have North and South of present Jharkhand. Madhya Pradesh into two, Northern and Southern. Maharashtra into three, Western, Central, and Eastern. Ashoka Chakra was incorporated in Indian flag on Dr. Ambedkar's suggestion. Dr. Ambedkar is instrumental in reduction in factory working hours to 8 hours daily. Enacted law for compulsory recognition of trade unions by enacting Indian Trade Unions Act in 1926. Dr. Ambedkar was instrumental in bringing the establishment of employment exchange in India, the largest exchange which provides services to the investors. Established employees state insurance. India is the first nation East Asian countries to bring insurance act. Dr. Ambedkar was instrumental in drafting legislation for fixing minimum wages for labor in November 28, 1942. Dr. Ambedkar enacted the Coal Mine Safety Amendment Bill for the benefit of workers on January 31, 1944. On April 8, 1945, he brought the MICA Mines Labor Welfare Fund, which helped the workers with housing, water supplies, education, entertainment, improvement of education facilities and standards of living. Post World War II, he was the chairman of the Central Works and Electric Power Construction Policy Committee. Created regional grid system, which was extended to national grid system and instrumental in creation of power supply department, that is state electricity boards. In 1942, Dr. Ambedkar drafted the Indian Statical Act. He is instrumental in bringing technical training schemes and skilled workers. Of course, today what we see in MSMEs in Government of India, that he visualized in 1942. His major achievement was the establishment of two technical organizations, presently known as Central Water Commission and Central Electricity Authority. The proposal for creation of Central Irrigation Waterways Advisory Board was approved by Dr. Ambedkar in September 1944. Subsequently, it became Central Waterways Irrigation and Navigation Commission and was approved by Dr. Ambedkar in April 1945. It became Central Water Power Irrigation and Navigation Commission on 16 January 1948 and subsequently it became Central Water and Power Commission in April 1955. It was bifurcated into Central Water Commission and Central Electricity Authority in October 1974. He created the Central Technical Power Board on 8th November 1944 for power system development, hydropower station sites, hydroelectric surveys, analyzing problems of electricity generation and thermal power station investigation, which was subsequently merged with Central Power Commission and Central Water and Power Commission in April 1955. He laid the foundation for the development of infrastructure in India, such as electricity, power, irrigation, communication, roads, transport services, and technical workforce were tested as prerequisite for industrial and agriculture development. He suggested interlinking of major South Indian rivers. He was a man of vision and foresight, which of course we did later on. Instrumental in creating the multi-purpose river valley projects and large dam technologies in India. He was instrumental in laying down the Damodar Valley project, the first multi-purpose river valley project in India in 1944 on the lines of Tanse Valley Authority. Bhakra Dam, India's largest multi-purpose river valley project, highest gravity dam in India. The Son River Valley project, the Hirakund Dam, the longest dam in India. He was the first person in India had made an effort for establishment of Damodar Valley project. He was the pioneer of multi-purpose river projects in India. Besides this, now I'll come to his personal achievements, what he has done throughout his life as an individual. This was his services to the nation. Besides the chairman of the drafting committee of Constitution of India, which we see today India's vibrant democracy. The first Indian to pursue an economics debate abroad, he is also the first PhD in economics and the first double doctorate holder in economics in South Asia. He was also among the highest educated Indians of his generation. During his 3 years at Columbia University at the age of 22, Dr. Ambedkar took 29 courses in economics, 11 in history, 6 in sociology, 5 in philosophy, 4 in anthropology, 3 in politics, and 1 each in elementary French and German. Dr. Ambedkar was master in 64 subjects. He knew 9 languages. Apart from this, he studied all religion of world comparatively for almost 21 years. He completed 8 years of his studies in just 2 years and 3 months. At London School of Economics, he is the first and the only person in the world to receive valuable doctorate named Doctor of All Sciences from London School of Economics. Dr. Ambedkar has the highest number of statues in the world. In 1950, his first statue was built in Kolhapur city. Dr. Ambedkar is the only Indian whose statue is attached with the Karl Marx in London Museum. His birth anniversary is also celebrated all over the world. Recently, he was declared the man of century. Now, what we are seeing is there are a lot of changes in the world. World is changing very rapidly. Recently, we have seen lots of anti-national and anti-establishment movements. And let me clear here first, Dr. Ambedkar was not against violence. He has never conducted any dharna or agitation during his entire life, despite facing all odds in his life. Throughout his career. He never went for any agitation. Truly believe in democratic principles. He agitated through his writings. And at the same time contributed to the nation and to the society as well. So what we are recently seeing, a lot of anti-national and anti-establishment movements have started in different parts of the world. They are hostile to social, economic, and political principles of ruling government. Their aim is to overthrow the existing power structure in society through vibrant, violent protests and agitations. Anti-establishment debates are common because they pretend to touch on everybody's aspect of life. Even innocent questions would escalate into angry debates. For example, they say, do we need to spend millions or lakhs on a foreign war or a space program when our schools are falling apart? As in early debates, there are valid and unsupported arguments on both sides like make love, not war. Further, these anti-establishment groups adopt conventions in composition to establishment, adopt contraventions in opposition to the establishment. They appeal people by saying like t-shirt and blue jeans become uniform for their youth because their parents wore collar shirts and slacks. drug use with illegal means are favored over illegal consumption of legal consumption of alcohol? Promoting peace and love are the antidote of promulgation of hatred and war? Living in gentle poverty is considered more honest than a house in suburbs? Over time, anti-establishment messages crept into the popular culture, songs, fashion, movies, lifestyle choices, and television we see in everyday life. They're also pioneering hijacking certain unfortunate incidents sometimes occurred in the society. Like recently, you must have noticed Black Lives Matter movement, which reached a new level after brutal murder 46-year-old. By a 46-year-old African-American George Floyd by a white police officer is shaping this revolution. Black across the world are joined by Asians and white Democrats and the process of rewriting history are bringing down the statutes of slave traders and racist peoples theologized by colonists. We've also seen some castes and anti-establishment groups in India favoring Black Lives Matter movement, though it has nothing to do with Indian culture and society. They claim caste and race are two sides of same coin, though it's not actually. American anthropologist and Ambedkar's point of view on caste and race are distinct and different. Let us see.
Let me just interrupt you for just a second, because that is, in American context, this is a really critical thing, and we want to really dwell into it because we want to see the connection between, the movement, because as you probably know, that a lot of people who are on the political left in America are going from universities and are going to university campuses to the administrators and student bodies, and they're going to corporations, and they're saying that, caste and race should be, and caste oppression should be added as one, a caste should be added as one of the protected classes. That means give special legal protection. But before we go there, let me just, if you don't mind, let me go to Priyaji. She's been patiently waiting, and let her just chime in a little bit and talk a little bit about it. So that you have some questions for Priyadidi. So why don't you go ahead and start there, and we come back to Vinodji, because Vinodji, we have a whole bunch of questions to ask you and learn from you when it comes to caste in America. So please give us a minute and we'll be right back to you. So that goes.
Yes. I wanted to actually, what I was going to ask Priyadi would play into the second phase of our conversation with Divakarji. And I think that's why the question I have for Priyaji is because Vinodji so nicely pointed out that the history of Dr. Ambedkar and how he grew up in British India and then how independent India embraced and worked with his ideas, revolutionary ideas on emancipation and development. But Priyadi comes from a part of the Indian subcontinent that was not part of India after 1947. And Priyadi grew up in what was East Pakistan and part of Pakistan until 1971, and then became Bangladesh. So Priyadi, tell me what the Dalit and the Bahujan community faced in Pakistan, and then later on, your personal experiences and how that has gone on in the last 73 years. Tell us about how the Dalits were treated in what is Pakistan and later became Bangladesh. What was Pakistan? Your sound is off. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I am very grateful to be here at this discussion on the Baba Saheb Ambedkar, the 130th birth anniversary. My tribute to him, and all of you discussed about this great person. My respect to Vinodji to educate us about this great person, and Ajay Shah and Utsav and this Hindu Pact, you are doing the perfect work to educate the world how we have this brilliant person, how the our society moving forward, how this a person can change a society, a country, and being a movement and change the life of millions and millions of people. So I'm very thankful this Hindu Pact for this great initiative and give me this opportunity to talk in that very in this way about this great person. But you know, in as a Bangladeshi, I can say we have a very little idea, and you can say almost as a Bangladeshi people, you don't have any idea about Baba Saheb Ambedkar work, because when the country was divided in 1947 after the partition, his most of his work in the adapting the constitution and all other movement by Baba Saheb Ambedkar was started. And in Bangladesh part, government doesn't recognize the Dalit issue. And I am this person only in 2001 started this work for the Dalit community. So in history, in the social work, the government work, Dalit is not a word in Bangladesh. Although this the same people, same culture, and the same sufferings are having all this community, but there is no initiative to minimize this suffering, to address this suffering, because and in Bangladesh, you know, it's a very fertile land. So we have this community, the clean air community and the cobbler community. Mostly the British government bring them from India. They came from India to Bangladesh as a cleaner. The Horijan is still now they're known as Horijan community. I'm working hard to make change this word, the Dalit. And I'm working for this word or this community 22 years. And in Bangladesh, there is no project by the government. There is no nothing. These communities, you can say, is uncounted, is absent community. Mostly, you'll be astonished to hear this Dalit community, there are 8 million by population, but in 1991, in census document, Bangladesh government make 1,250 cleaner community. Basically, they are not counted, they are absent from the census, from all other, the development process. There was not a, before 2011, there was not a single coin budget for this community. So I have started to bring this issue through our research, socioeconomic condition of Dalit community in Dhaka city. It was my first research in 2000, and it was published in a Bangladesh, the renowned English newspaper, Daily Star. The summary was reported there. And from that time, I was trying to bring this issue in the government development process. And yeah, every people, when I had a meeting with the policymaker, but I used 4 types of strategy to bring this Dalit issue in the surface. What are these 4 type of strategy? First one, research. The second one, the community that develop the community level organization, the Horijan Oikyo Porishad. If I wanted to talk them Dalit, they feel, okay, no, we are not Dalit. Dalit is very neglected, and this word, and the Muslim community of Bangladesh, they talk, okay, in Bangladesh, that is no discrimination. In the Islam, that is no discrimination. So in Bangladesh, that is no Dalit. So you can understand with the county, when the county policies, the estate has a religion, the estate religion is Islam. So talking Dalit, it's hard. Then my third policy was to award the policymaker. How I did this? The community, the researcher, the academician, the university teacher, the lawmaker, and the government official, and journalist, and the community. And all community I have bring in a table, round table, many, many round table. And through this round table, I wanted to inform, by share my research, how this community, and what is the present situation. Then people, the gentle people, they said, yes, we have this community, but they don't know in Bangladesh perspective, where Dalit community living, what is their condition, what is their life? Nobody knows that. Yeah, people are coming, they are making the road and all area that nasty. And in the morning, they are coming and washing. This is clean, it's a good city. But who is doing this work? Nobody knows that. Where they are living, nobody knows that. Because they are living in a very quarantine area. People are not living with this community. The general people are not living with this community. And Dalit do not have any right to live with other community. So it's an absent community in Bangladesh.
So Didi, I wanted to hold on 1 minute. I have a question on that. In your conversation, you mentioned that in Islamic countries, they refuse to acknowledge the communities like Harijan or Dalit, as you pointed out. This is something that Pakistan does too, because supposedly there is equality in Islam, in quotes, as I say it, because it's not in reality, it hasn't happened anywhere in the world. But in both Pakistan and in Bangladesh, there seems to be a very serious effort to ensure that the Hindu communities, especially the downtrodden Hindu communities, do not get opportunities to rise up. In fact, in Pakistan, there are certain jobs that are clearly only meant for the downtrodden Hindu communities. They're not allowed to do anything else. Is there something like similar in Bangladesh, or what is your opinion and experience on that?
Yes, the same thing. This community, I am talking about the undocumented people. So they do not have any education. They do not have any opportunity to do any other thing. So they are working where? The municipality and the hospital and the industry and the rail station and the port. This is their area of work. And they are living in the government one room, 10 person in 10 by 10 room, three generation living together. And you'll be astonished to hear the city corporation salary. It is 600 a month, still now, 1200 a month. In Narayanganj, the city corporation, I was able to increase 600 taka salary. It was 1600. In Dhaka city corporation, that is in 4000, In most of the city corporation in Bangladesh, the cleaner community salary is 1200 monthly salary, 1200 to 2000. And still now there is six municipality, they are paying monthly 600. And that is another thing. This community, yes, in the city corporation, there is 400 cleaner. Say 50 is the Dalit from the Dalit community and 350 from the Muslim community. Okay, this Muslim community will never clean the road. They will not work. These 50 people rotationally, weekly, 6 day or 7 day, they will clean one day this area, next day other area, but other 350, the Muslim community, the cleaner, they will not clean, but they will get salary. And this cleaner community and the cobbler community and the tea garden worker, you will be astonished to hear the tea garden worker is still they have one family can have one job, and one job they can get 101 taka a day, and they can work 24 day. And you can understand the 6-member family or 7-member family or 4-5-member family, how they are running their life with 2400 taka a month.
So Priyati, that is such a huge discriminatory government sanctioned discrimination, and I think we need to follow Dr. Ambedkar's words.
Yes.
And Dr. Ambedkar said, be educated, be organized, and be agitated.
Okay.
And I think these are the kind of words that we need to probably follow. Let me bring Vinodji back into the conversation. Vinodji, I want you to continue your narrative that you started, and then bring Priyaji with a recent American experience in there, and then blend her Bangladesh experience and Indian experience and US experience together. As I was saying, that there are a lot of caste-based, resolutions that are coming up in America. A lot of narrative building that is going on in America based on, in reality, most people who are second generation, third generation, etc., don't know their own caste. But there is an attempt in America that is being made for people to, make people identify their caste, and these are people who don't know. So this is basically an attempt to divide the Hindu community. And I would like to know from your perspective, and then from Priyaji's perspective, what should be, how does Hindu community, how does Hindu community respond to that? And also, while you're at it, I want to actually take a step back, Vinodji, because you have such a deep knowledge of Ambedkarji's life. And I want to talk to you about why Ambedkarji adopted Buddha Dharma, and what brought about this change, and what is the impact of that change in Bharat? What is the impact of that change around the world? Because whatever Ambedkarji did has impacted the whole world. So please walk us through, continue what he was doing. So continue with his, Parivartan to Buddha Dharma, adoption of Buddha Dharma. And then tell us a little bit about how this is playing out in Bharat, around the world, and what is the impact of his work in America?
So, Ajayji, there is a mixed questions. One is convergent to the Buddhism and first Indian-born Americans. In what perspective they see the caste system in India? The two things. So we see that those Indians who are born in America, they perhaps not face the caste discrimination there. The few organizations in America, fueled by some external forces, were trying to create a rift without having any basis and knowledge about history. So the first and foremost advice and opinion or a statement which I would like to give is to tell our young generation about history. Until unless we read the history, we cannot frame the future. So to frame the future, we should know about history. The history says there was a caste discrimination. Still in some parts of India, there is caste discrimination, but there are reasons to it. When these reasons are eliminated from the society, the automatically caste, the problems arising because of the caste also subsides. I don't find those reasons in American society. And to understand it, we need to go to the scholars who has done a lot of work on caste and race. Like Cox Oliver Campbell, written his article Race and Caste, a Distinction, and elaborately discussed about the caste, features of caste and race as well. So therefore, by taking a shield of racial discrimination, we cannot promote the hostility among Hindus generated or on the pretext of the caste discrimination in India that has to be minimized. They are not two sides of same coin. Their history, their evaluation, their applicability, their consequence into society are different. There, nothing is common among them. So the element of commonality, common things, is to be eliminated one by one. And that only, could only be eliminated by study and working hard on subject. Like I say, the social scientists have been relying upon the idea of caste relations are like caste relations. However, a comparison between certain features of Indian and Western society shows caste relations are not race relations. Both are distinct form of social organization. The race relations can best be studied as a form of class exploitation. And the assumption that they are caste relations is confusing and misleading. It needs to go to the students who are studying in universities. And I say it's important to point out few differences between caste and race. Caste crystallized over several millennia of Indian history, primarily as a cosmology which allowed pastoral and agriculture colonizers from the northwest of subcontinent to gradually colonize thousands of groups and communities who were previously not organized into caste. Whereas the race has altogether a different. We can identify a racial discrimination on the basis of skin, but caste we can't. So therefore, they have both different implications. They're born out from a different atmosphere, culture, and altogether are different things. Now, the second question which you have raised, yes, Mr. Utsav, perhaps you want to...
I wanted to ask a follow-up question on this aspect before you go into the second part of the question that Ajay Bhai put together. So you very rightly pointed out that there is a very defined and vested attempt to bring caste and race on the same platform and use it as a geopolitical tool. Now, we are observing a certain group of people doing that in America. And I'm pretty sure similar groups are operating in the Indian subcontinent as well. And there is a growing trend that, and it is a pattern, and sometimes pattern lead to a clear definition of agenda as well. The pattern that we are observing here is that these groups usually come from a very strong Christian evangelist background that are interested in conversion activities. And so tell us about what your experience has been in the Indian subcontinent, because if we find a congruence between these two patterns in America and India, then it should lead us and our viewers to understand that there is actually being an attempt made by a certain geopolitical and in the past, a colonizer group in to fish in troubled waters and exploit the fault lines that exist within different groups of the Hindu society.
They're doing in India and in subcontinent as well, the same activity. They generate it, they take trade, they get money, they get resources from abroad and apply in the Indian subcontinent as well. The modus operandi is same. The repercussions are different. Replications are different so far as the because the society compositions are different, the cultures are different. But if we go to the root and find out the cause and effect, almost same. See, the basic fact is they don't want to see India as emerging vibrant democracy in world. That's the biggest threat to them. The Hindu culture, the Hindu society, the Hindu values are threat to them. The old age Hindu culture is a threat because all these religions are born after almost 3,000 year old or 3,500 year old. They have a live history. They have recorded history. So therefore, by taking one or second idea, cloying in the grab of academics and academia, then influencing youths. So we need to study Marx. Then only we are able to understand what Marx say.
Unless we go to the college and the schools and read Marx, how do we come to know how it is different from Dr. Ambedkar? Why we are bringing them on the same platform? Marx has never come out from Europe, born in Germany. His childhood is, he remained during his childhood in Boone, then Bisford, Paris, then died in London. He has never got any chance to visit India or any other country, Southeast Asian countries. How his story could be applicable here? So academically, we need to be resourceful and strong. We can only give a challenge through academics.
Dr. Diwakar, it's very interesting you point out about Marx, because, you know, in the global context, especially in the Western world, the Christian right wing, many of whom are white supremacists, by the way, are fighting with the Marxist leftist narrative builders throughout the world. Except when it comes to attacking Hindus, they both join hands and then we are the target together. So it almost unites these two diverse edges of the ideological spectrums with their own fallacies, with their old faults. And you put a Hindu in front of them and they will join together and start talking about caste.
Yes, of course. This Marx inherited the idea of class and class struggle from utopian socialism and the theories of Henry de Saint-Simon, unlike French historian. Marx made a class struggle as a central fact of social evolution only after 18th century. He born in 1818. We are not born in 1818. Our ideas are not born in 1818. So the idea of Marx came only after 1818. That he spent whatever life he had in only Europe. So how can the thought process which took birth after 1818, industrial evolution? He has seen the class exploitation. He has not seen the vibrant fact about Indian social culture. So I'm coming to that. The Marx made class struggle and the central fact of social evolution. If you read the history of all existing human society, the history of caste, class struggle, how could it be? The history of mankind, how could it be a history of class struggle? They failed to understand. We fail to understand as on day. The world has failed to understand. In Marx's view, the dialectical nature of history is expressed in class struggle with the development of capitalism, from where they have borrowed this fact. Capitalism, they borrowed only in after 1818. So how the world was governing before that? The class struggle takes the acute form. Two basic classes around which other less important classes are grouped, opposed to each other in capitalist system, the owner and the means of production, burgheries and the workers and proprietors, they have nothing to say except beyond this. So entire human society, entire governance, entire human values, they're limited to the two words, production and means and profits, that's all. But Dr. Ambedkar, Indian culture did not say so. Like I say, when I say, if you appreciate, Dr. Ambedkar was born 8 years after Karl Marx died. Dr. Ambedkar, who wrote Buddha and Karl Marx, Buddha and his Dhamma and Buddha and Karl Marx. I'm coming to your second part of question and query. Championed the cause of social justice and annihilation of caste in Indian society. Until unless you read annihilation of caste, you can't understand Indian society. By reading the Communist Manifesto, it had nothing to do with the Indian society. Indian labor, Indian worker, Indian workforce. You had to have read Annihilation of Caste to understand Indian society in Dr. Ambedkar's perspective. Otherwise, you can't. The Communist Manifesto that Ambedkar wrote, Annihilation. See, now if Marx could have time travel to 20th century and had a one-to-one dialogue with Ambedkar. Imagine, it would have made a stirring democratic debate. But since that has not happened, various groups have often drawn a common ground between Marxism and Dalit politics espoused by Doctor, both of which aims to strike at roots of exploitation and oppressed. However, Marx notions are nowhere applicable to Indian caste culture. and there is no heavily influenced by societal and geographical differences are apparent in the Indian society. Karl Marx was a German philosopher who traveled extensively across Germany, France, Belgium, and the United Kingdom. And these concepts are based on social practice prevailed in that geographical areas only. He has no idea of deep-rooted, our deep-rooted culture. So we can't bring them on the same platform. Why Dr. Ambedkar adopted Buddhism? There was reason to it. If we go back to 1940, 40 to 46, the kind of caste, you know, you can say, the caste oppression he has seen in his life. So he only converted to Buddhism, which is also a form of Indian values and culture originated in India, based on justice and equality, brother and fraternity. What do we read in Buddhism? Eightfold paths. Samyak drishti, samyak vichar, samyak sanhita. All are eightfold paths too. So they are closely correlated and we both coexist together. They are not separate and distinct and different.
Right. And Vinodji, that's a really good point. That's a really good point because he was, you know, people did entice him to convert to Islam. He yes. said no. People enticed him to convert to, Christianity. He said no. People asked him to convert to abandon everything and become a communist, and he specifically said no. And he was also asked to become a Sikh, and he said no. So he very deliberately, after a lot of consideration for years and years, he decided to adopt Buddha Dharma.
Yes, of course, right.
And that is the kind of, and he even though he adopted, he never abandoned the Bhartiya roots, the under Bhartiya roots of Dharma, even when he moved away from the Vedic Hindu Dharma in many ways, right?
Yes. So for the knowledge of your audience, let me tell you two, three facts. I don't know how do people abroad in America, London, see Dr. Ambedkar, but I'll tell you truly, while I stayed in America and London, the Bharat has never come out from his heart. All his thesis, philosophy, research was Bharat-centric. All his books was Bharat-centric. He came to India, despite facing all adversities in his personal life. He spent entire life in India. So that India could live long.
Right, right.
It is very interesting, Ajay bhai. I just wanted to interject, you know. After what Vakatji said about Ambedkar's personal love for Bharat and the civilization of India. The Marxists went on record calling him an opportunist and an imperial stooge, the communists of those days. So it is, you know, it is very ironic that today, globally, you know, it's the communists that pretend to espouse the so-called Dalit cause and so-called Ambedkar's voice, especially in American campuses. And if you see, you know, there is no a higher form of deception and misinformation than that. And not just that, you know, to add to the mix, the Christian right wing, many of whom are white supremacists, you know, that takes the cake. You know, it is really ironic and it is really our fault that we have not been able to educate people and share the information that needs to be shared. You know, part of the reason why, you know, you have these narratives floating around in America is because we have failed to bring up the history that Vinodji is bringing up. We have failed to bring up the reality that Priya Saha is bringing up in terms of what happens in the Indian subcontinent. Carry on, Ajay bhai.
No, that I was actually going to say exactly the same thing, that there's interesting quote from the communists about Dr. Ambedkar, and you just said the same thing. So yeah, I actually, since you mentioned, America, let me, Vinodji, before I get back to you, because Priyaji had just started talking about it, I want to just hear one thing, Priyaji, because when you came to America and you sought the refugee status, because there was a threat to you in going back, because after you met the president of America at that time, President Trump, and then there were a lot of threats and you could not go back, so you had to stay back, and you narrated that story last time. How many of the organizations, such as Hindus for Human Rights, who purport to speak up for Hindu human rights, which we know we have now proved conclusively that they never do, how many of them came to your defense?
That is a great story. Nobody. The organization in Bangladesh, Bangladesh is the top country in the base of the NGO, non-profit organization. And we have the largest and Nobel winner NGO and largest NGO back. And I can share with you how the minority facing problem, the religious minority community, you cannot register a organization in the name of minority, in the name of Hindu. No, you will not. You cannot find an organization like this. You have to have a different type of name. You cannot use this name. If you use the Hindu, you will not get registered. And there is no Hindu organization. There is organization, different name. The only the Hindu Mahajot came existent in few years, and this organization already broken 4 times by the government on other agencies. So they are struggling for survival. I am the organizing secretary of Hindu, Buddhist and Christian Unity Council. And this organization dismissed me on the third day. They had to, with a press conference. And all other, the government organization, Hindu Kalyan Trust, the Buddhist Kalyan Trust, the Christian Kalyan Trust, all together, they had a press conference and they have to go. And some other organization, they have to have a press conference because government make them bound to had a press conference against me. But the funny thing is nobody challenged my data, what I have talked. Nobody bring this data. They are talking, Priya Shah talk, the in country matter, she bring it to the international level. It's not wise, but they never talk about the data. They never talk my anything challenge. And the community, when I talk, my whole house was surrounded by a criminal group, and whole the media, if you go to check the media, more than 15 days, all talk show was about Priya Shah.
Right.
And yeah, they wanted to blame me to hide the causes. No. Because every day—
I wanted to interject in between and just ask you, how about American organization? All these organizations that are in America, who claim to be voice of the Dalit community, who claim to quote unquote represent their narratives. Where were they when you needed help in America? Did anybody—
A little bit more pointed question, Utsoda. So Priyaji, did Equality Labs come to help you in America?
How can I say, Utsoda, but know everything during this hard time, because I came here for two days, three nights, when I was not able to go back. Can I tell the Utsav take me? No organization take my responsibility and personally.
So no Hindus for Human Rights, no Communality Combat, no Equality Lab,
No, only two person, Utsav and Jay, they take me to my Bangladeshi family house. And I was hidden in their house 20 days. I was not able to go in the outside. I was not stand in the front of the window because other people may saw me. So they will be in trouble. Then after 20 days, I got shelter in the Utsav house for another 20 days. So, I changed my address 14 times within 12 months.
Yeah.
14 times I had to change, and I was in hidden place. Only I have to be grateful to Utsav and Jay and American Hindu Coalition. They just talk with me. They call me. Yeah.
No,
that's it. But no organization, they know me. You know, some organization are involved, but they never ask me. They never call me. Right. Several times I email, I call them. They feel shy to pick up my phone.
So
they didn't pick up my phone.
No, that's very telling, because these are the organizations, they only want political mileage out of dividing the society. They don't really want to help people when they need. Vinodji, you were trying to say something. Please go ahead.
So you referred the name of an organization. And there are certain many more organizations in America and India as well. I have one sentence for them. Jill, in Hindi, I would prefer to say it because
the message
would be clear and loud. जिन संगठनों की बुनियाद दास प्रथा के ऊपर रुकी हुई है, उसको प्रफुल्लित और बढ़ाने पर रुकी हुई है, वो मानवता के लिए क्या संदेश देंगे, वो मानव के लिए क्या काम करेंगे, इसके लिए इतिहास गवाह है. सो वी नीड नॉट टू वरी अबाउट देम.
वेरी वेल सेड. कैन यू ट्रांसलेट टू इंग्लिश, बिकॉज लॉट ऑफ आवर ऑडियंस मेंबर्स मे नॉट नो. I understand, but I just want to be a very powerful statement.
Those organizations whose foundation are based on slavery, they can't give any message to humanity and human values. Human values and humanity has no relevance, no importance for them, because their entire culture, their life, their foundation is based on the exploitation of human beings in the form of slavery. It's been condemned in today's world. No society, South Asian society, Indian society, ever thought, ever dreamed, ever think of chain, can who could chain human beings into the iron chains and sell and involve themselves into the trade of human sale. So they can't be a messenger to the society and youth. We need to tell to our youths in colleges and universities that this is their past, this is their conduct, this is their nature. We need to expose them to the name from the beginning to the last. And this we can only do by heavy reading, by knowing our history, and by knowing their culture, their future plans as well. We need to expose them. We need to bring them up front. We need to confront them up front. And we can only confront them because nowadays they recite name of Dr. Ambedkar many a times. Whenever any incident, bad or good, happened in world, they come together and start saying lot of bringing Dr. Ambedkar's ideology into all nonsense, non-productive ideas. We need to tell them, in 1955, Dr. Ambedkar wrote first book that was India-centric, Indian ancient Indian commerce. The second book he has written in 1916, National Dividend of India and Historic Analytical Study, that was also about India. The third book which has written, The Problems of Rupees, Its Origin and Solution, was about Indian economy. So throughout his life, he has written about India. He has worked for India. He died for India and Indian values. He converted to a religion which was India-centric, based on the foundation of humanity, values, brotherhood, equality, love, compassion. And they are embracing nowadays portraying Dr. Ambedkar into altogether a different picture to justify their anti-establishment propaganda. We also see lot of communist and anti-establishment groups, NGOs working in India by television, by having a photograph of Dr. Ambedkar behind him. So they can't adopt Dr. Ambedkar like this. The nation will not allow them. We will not allow them. You will not allow them. The Indians will not allow them.
No, this is absolutely appropriation of Ambedkar ji, right?
We will not allow them to hijack Dr. Ambedkar in such a fashion.
Yeah.
It's written, everything is written. Everything is in codified.
Correct.
You can't hijack in such fashion. So therefore, it's a clear message to them. Just we need to make our younger generations, we need to tell them what is what in black and white. And they will automatically vanish from the system. Smaller, little incident would happen and they will come together. They will cry, weep, nothing is going to happen from there. This nonsense.
So Vinodji, let me ask you this question, because a lot of the organizations in America, especially, they have tried now for last 3, 4, 5 years to brand Hindutva groups, Hindutva organizations, whether it is the World Hindu Council of America or HSS, which is the Hindu Swayamsevak Sangh, and anyone who, even people who are not part of Hindutva organizations, but people who, even ordinary Hindus that go to mandirs, they've been branded in the worst derogatory sense. But when it really came to Ambedkar's own life examples, Ambedkar did have first-hand experience in dealing with Sangh, with RSS, and he did have direct connection, political, personal connection with Dattopant Thengdiji, who was one of the most important leaders of Sangh, who was the founder of Bharatiya Mazdoor Sangh, played a role in founding of Akhil Bharatiya Vidyarthi Parishad, and several other organizations that are now considered part of the Sangh Parivar. And we have some direct quotes, but you know, like for example, one of the quotes that says, "The day anyone of you becomes bigger Dalit than Thengdiji or Thengdi, I will make you General Secretary of the Federation." And he's talking about the Scheduled Caste Federation that Baba Saheb Ambedkar had founded. And Baba Saheb Ambedkar, when he ran for elections, Thengdiji was his campaign manager. So I think Sangh and Ambedkarji have actually a much closer connection in terms of working together for the upliftment of society than the people on the left who are now trying to appropriate him, correct?
Not just that, I want to add, he actually went into that election in coalition with Hindu Mahasabha.
Yeah.
Vinod, your mic.
Hindu Mahasabha supported him.
Right.
Yes. See, I don't find any reference in entire history where been Dr. Ambedkar ever criticized Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. I don't find any reference. So those who are saying anything today, they neither read Dr. Ambedkar nor they have read anything else. Even they have no idea about history. So I in my entire academic career, I have never found any reference whereby Dr. Ambedkar had criticized Sangh or any other organizations affiliated to us. So whatever they are saying is their figment of imaginations. They only create things, fuel them, spread women, that's all.
So,
we really don't have to worry much about them.
Vinodji, tell us a little bit about the contribution that Sangh is making to bring about the real equality. We call it, the true Samarashtra. That is the term that is being used. And tell us a little bit about Samrasta that was originally started by Ramesh Patangaji, and now it has grown all over the country. And really, the end result of this work, and we mentioned this last week when we were talking about it, that look at the real results. Don't look at the narrative building, the political narrative building, but the real results. If you look at the president of India today, who has come from Sangh background, he is from the Dalit community. Look at the Prime Minister of India, he is from the other backward class community. And these are the torchbearers of the Hindu political movement today. And so there is some real changes that has been brought about by Sangh in the society. You are in India, tell us your firsthand view on this.
So, well, to respond to this query, I need an entire day session. Because there are a lot of work.
We will do a workshop with you. I promise you, Vinodji, I promise you that after today, I realize that we need to not do a 1 hour show, which is one hour now, but we need to do a workshop with multiple speakers. And I promise you that within the next 3 months to 6 months, I will set up a workshop for American Hindus on this issue. So, and we will, you'll be our honored. I'm hoping that you'll be our honored guest for that.
Thank you. So nice of you. See, I don't find any incident. Again, I'm saying my personal experience, whereby I can say, or I have never realized in my life any sort of discrimination on caste line in RSS meetings, sammelans, or patterns. I think this is suffice to make people understand that this is an organization which is purely dedicated to the nation's service. Nothing more, nothing less. Punya Bharat Bhumi, Vibrant India, Akhanda Bharat, Ek Bharat, Shrestha Bharat. So whosoever will come to know to achieve the motto of Ek Bharat, Shrestha Bharat, Vibrant India, United India, everything will be eliminated, faced, and will not be recognized, tolerated by Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh. So, Sangh has been doing 1925. The first and only work of Sangha is to make society homogeneous, samras, one society. That's the only work. What they are doing? Do they contribute to any GDP? I may be wrong or right, but what I realize is the only motto is to eliminate all sort of discrimination in the society to make a ek rashtra, shrestha rashtra. And the process of elimination, discrimination is a continuous process. We keep on doing this. To build the robust India, vibrant India, we keep on eliminating all these issues. So there is dedicated activity, we call it the Samajik Samarasta Gativiti. The sole motive and objective of the activity is to minimize the caste prejudices in the Indian society. And this is the only organization in India which is doing this. But people say a lot of things, they have their own mind. We should not bother about that. And at the same time, we should know the art of making them relevant, ignoring them. The best way is ignore them. Keep working on your own mission. That will bring good result in the society. And after all, the society will recognize. The nation will recognize. Yeah, so in detail, we will talk on some other day. We have a lot of incidents, a lot of things to say on this. Mm-hmm. But it will take a lot of time because I don't know where to begin and where to last.
Yeah.
As I said, yes, go ahead.
You know, Abhinavji, in Bangladesh, in India, there is a many more work, that is quota, and many government policy for the Dalit, because the Babasaheb Ambedkar initiated through this constitution. But in Bangladesh, we do not have any such a work for any quota or anything. Only for 8 million people, the government from now, this year they have 25 crore taka budget, you know. Then how many taka they will get per head? 8 million people, 25 crore taka. And this some government project, they're making some project and they're using by their own. And now a day has come, they're making the Dalit and discriminated the Bihari people, the Pakistani group, they are settled in Bangladesh. So we are very unfortunate. We are not getting Babasaheb Ambedkar's, the research benefit of his suggestion, of his work. Or Bangladeshi Dalit community, they are not getting any benefit because government doesn't recognize the Dalit community. Are, you know, the, all are the same people, same community, the same society. The country was divided, but so society, culture, and any other, it didn't abolish. It is existing in everywhere. So we want to work together in Bangladesh perspective. The people, they are facing the serious discrimination, and every day, 2, 3, 4 houses are vandalizing, people are killing. And in March, they have vandalized the 12th Hindu temple. And on Babri Mosque, they shout across the world, and it's still today. But in Bangladesh, every year, more than 200 temple vandalizing by the Bangladesh Muslim community. And Dalit, they are killing Dalit, they're burning the Dalit house, they're discriminating, they're torturing, they're doing all this atrocity on the Dalit community, but there is no voice at all. And so my request, please talk about Bangladesh. That will be great. We want to take the benefit of the, we want to get the benefit of the Baba Saheb Ambedkar, the suggestions and his Nobel work. And how we can get this?
Priyaji, maybe Sunita Vishwanathan from Hindus for Human Rights will hear this and jump to the cause. We hope, because she finds a human rights cause everywhere except when it affects Hindus.
Well, she'll have to take permission from the Council for American Islamic Relations first. So.
Maybe. Yeah, you should
have directly addressed Council for American Islamic Relations instead of
maybe we'll go to CARE and see if they can support Hindus for Human Rights in just maybe at least speaking for the Dalits in Bangladesh. That might be a good place to start instead of doing worthless change.org petitions. But I'll leave that aside for now. So there are any, let me ask our two valued guests if they have any final comments. We had a lot to talk about. We were just scratching the surface, and I feel, since Vinodji has graciously, I think, accepted to be part of the workshop, Vinodji, any final, we will set that up. We'll organize that. We'll invite a much broader audience to directly participate and interact with you. But Vinodji, any final thoughts before we bring this to a close? This is such an enlightening and educational, conversation. I cannot thank you guys enough. But this is, I do want to hear any closing statements that you may have. Please, Vinodji, go ahead.
The closing statement could be, we need to study more to confront and to give proper befitting reply to those who are criticizing Hinduism and Hindu values on the basis of fake narratives. To dispel those narratives, we need to understand and tell our generations to at least read good texts and books once in a week or 1 hour in 24 or 26, whatever it be feasible for them to study. That I think could be best for those who are staying abroad. And our children, our young generation could understand their motive, their mission, and their propaganda only by knowing truth about them. That's all. If any specific query, you can ask me, I would reply. But otherwise, what I can say on Dr. Ambedkar's birth anniversary, unite, agitate, educate.
So well put. Priyaji, any final comments?
Yes. In this August, his birth anniversary, my request is we need to know our culture, our heritage, and our glorious history. Not only that, we need to inform the world, and some people are using in their benefit in the misway. We need to challenge this every moment, keep on challenging so that truth will come and we'll be stronger and we'll be survive nicely. And we need to educate our next generation. And that's why we need some easy, you know, some write-up or books, internet basis, and the easy way to get about the religion, about the history, about the golden heritage of Indian subcontinent. That will be that we need to take an initiative. Thank you so much. Give this opportunity and
thank you
during this birth anniversary talk show.
Thank you. Thank you, Priyaji. Thank you very much. Today, actually, we have Rakhi Israni, who has joined us. She's the executive director for legal at Hindu Pact. And we throw open this invitation every week. And, you know, sometimes people join, sometimes they don't. But and today, Rakhi has joined. And she was also she's also a former president of Hindu Students Council in America. So, Rakhi, I don't want to put you on spot, but want to just kind of bring you into the conversation to say a few words if you'd like.
Sure. No, thank you. This was a wonderful conversation. Thank you, Vinerji, Priyaji. You know, I think it was, it's pretty enlightening because I think as you both kind of mentioned, we ourselves don't know our own history. And actually Vinerji, that quote you had said, it was very enlightening because I think what's happening in this country is that the, you know, from the perspective of slavery, where there was a caste system that was kind of developed here based on skin color, I think a lot of that is being superimposed on what happened in India without any context or knowledge. And so they're trying to condemn us to make themselves feel better. You know, I feel that that's what's happening. And the only way to do it is to educate not only ourselves first, but then the rest of society that, you know, that we come from a very different place. And, you know, the caste system was based on a very different notion. And that's the only way to really to fight this. You fight this with knowledge, fight ignorance with knowledge. So thank you very much, both of you. It was very enlightening.
Thank you. So that before we go to our regularly scheduled three small segments of 30 seconds each, final closing comments on Dr. Ambedkar's birth, observance that we are doing as Omnitude Day and Ekatmata Divas. Please go ahead.
Well, I think this was a fantastic gathering, and we, even though we are probably twice the amount of time over time, I think every moment of this discussion was worth listening to, and every moment needs to be shared with people, especially Americans who have very little context of India. So this was wonderful. Thank you so much, both of you. And every time we do shows at 2 o'clock at night, Ajay Bhai keeps adding more and more information. And I keep saying, Ajay Bhai, we are going to go up at least 100% over time. And he says, no, there is, we need to add more information. So as always, we are 100% over time.
Thank you. Thanks for pointing it out so publicly and holding me accountable for going over time. I do want to close this out with three of our regularly scheduled segments, because we do have three segments. So first of all, this week was a really sad week, and we issued a statement on this. The news of the week in America, where there was a mentally challenged person who went around in a shooting spree in Indianapolis. 9 people were killed. 4 of them were Sikhs. And we issued, as Hindu Pact, as VHPA, we issued a statement on that, obviously expressing our sorrow on the killing. And we also said that, the mental health issues in this country that have been so neglected need to be paid attention to. And as an organization that is involved in Seva in America, we stand ready to help the victims' families in any way we can. But as a society, as individuals, World Hindu Council of America and Hindu Pact definitely we are very saddened to hear this, and we condemn such random acts of violence and the immeasurable suffering that is caused by these acts of violence. The action item of the week, as you guys know, we talked about it a little bit last week. In the state of New Jersey, the latest state, now we have defeated this in the state of Maryland, we have defeated it in the state of New York. New Jersey, as the whack-a-mole continues, the New Jersey is the latest state to attempt and designate swastika as a symbol of hate with a bill, NJ Bill AB 174. And again, Hitler never used the word swastika. It was the Hakenkreuz, and nobody should be ever naming swastika in any bill and equating it with the symbol of hatred of any kind. Swastika was, is, and will remain a symbol of auspiciousness and a sacred symbol for over 1.5 billion followers, not just of dharmic traditions, but also people who are Native Americans, people who are Africans, people who follow the ancient European traditions and South American traditions. So billions and billions of people. And that cannot be erased. Hitler never used the word swastika, and no one should ever equate swastika with the hate symbol of any kind. So that, any thoughts on that before we go to the next segment, next 30-second segment, the good news of the week?
So I would also encourage people to try to find a pattern in why state after state is trying to come up with this legislation, even though they are failing each time. Who are the people behind it? Try to connect the dots, try to understand why they're doing it. And there is a larger political environment in America that is triggering this. And someday we will have a show on that. Someday we will discuss it in deep. In fact, we have done that in the past, but we have to keep doing it because, again, most of us don't know that Hitler actually never used the word swastika, a Sanskrit word. He used the word hooked cross, a Haken cross. Now, you know, when the word cross comes in, you know, they switch words very easily. So that would be my closing point on this.
And we have a petition. We request all of you to go to our website, hindupak.org/swastika, hindupak.org/swastika. Click on the button, participate in the petition, a general consent petition of any state legislation that comes up against the word swastika anywhere in America. So please go to hindupak.org/swastika, sign on to the petition and give and register your protest. The next quick segment with Sodha, good news, Hindu good news of the week. World Hindu Council of America, VHPA, conducted a successful COVID-19 vaccine camp in our Chicago center. The first time we were able to actually conduct a vaccine camp where the jabs were given, and you can see the picture. And I cannot thank our Chicago volunteers, including our president, Nirubhai Patel, our Amitabh Mittalji, our General Secretary of VHP America, is also in Chicago. So great job to the whole team. I don't want to single out one or two people, but the entire team for this fantastic work in conducting the vaccine for COVID-19 camp in Chicago. Utsada, the last two segments, 10 seconds each, and we always start the Hindu Seva Act of the Week. And so that no matter how much time we have, here's a 10-second clip that goes with it. So that, you know, what can I say? We do these shows on behalf of Hindu Pact and World Hindu Council of America. We would like to evolve into a much more professional organization than we are today. And today on our 50th show, we designate ourselves to be the charity or Seva Act of the Week. So please go to hindupact.org and donate, make contribution. Hindu advocacy in America really needs to be well-funded, and we can certainly use your help. So please go to hindupact.org, make a contribution. No contribution is too small. Even if you donate a dollar, it will go a long way. If you can donate more, we certainly can use the money. Please do go to hindupact.org, click on the donate button and donate the money. And finally, Utsada, our most anticipated segment of the week, not that everything else is not anticipated all week, but the most anticipated segment of the week, who are you going to designate the Hindu phobe of the week? Who hates Hindus this week, Utsada?
Well, sadly, Ajay bhai, that is something that we never run out of. And unfortunately, that is as unfortunate as it can be. Every week in America and around the world, Hindus are the target of hatred. And this time we are very sad to say that, you know, again, Christian right-wing groups, Christian fundamentalist groups have been attacking Hindus for yoga. And, you know, there is an article that came out in Guardian where they have claimed that yoga can lead to injury and make you psychotic and even convert you to Hindu dharma. So I would say that all these things probably could be true. Yeah, you have to take care of yourself when you're doing yoga. Don't get yourself injured and don't go crazy while doing yoga. Everything in moderation, that's also something Hindus try to do. And of course, if you do yoga, you will become a Hindu. So enjoy it and be a part of a civilization that is 7,000 years old. And if you still want to hate us, please do. And something will be set inside you that will set you free. Thank you so much.
So that I can tell you that after 50 episodes, I finally brought you around to having some amount of humor, that you started out on the first episode being so serious. And I kept telling you that you got to be a little bit, you got to lose it up.
Ajay, you are understated. I was always humorous.
I can see a sense of humor coming out of you finally. It only took a year to get to this point, but I hope it keeps evolving. With that, I want to once again thank our two very, very special guests. I want to thank Vinod Divakarji for joining in India, from India. Vinodji, it has been a real honor that you were able to join us. Thank you. Thank you very, very much for joining us. We cannot, we cannot thank you enough. Please do join us again when we do our show highlighting highlighting the work, the good work that you are doing in Bharat and how we can translate that work to America. Priyaji, every time I see you, I'm just, you are such an eloquent representative of the Bangladeshi Hindu community, and now not just Bangladeshi Hindu community, but Hindu community in America. And we'll certainly, this is the second time you're on our show, the show that never has guests. We have maybe had guests in our show, maybe only what, 4 times or 5 times in 50 shows. And for you to be on our show twice, it's really truly our honor. I think the community is better off because of you, and you have not failed the community. So thank you again for joining us. And Utsada, as always, always an honor and pleasure to host this show. For people who don't know you, Utsada is Utsav Chakravarti. He is the executive director of Hindu Pack. He is the co-host of this show, and I am the co-host of the show. He's the host of the show. I am Ajay Shah. I am the president of World Hindu Council of America, or BHPA. With that, unless Utsada, you have any final comments?
I just wanted to thank Aarti and Rakhi, both of whom spent their time and joining us and gave us very good suggestions and thought. Thank you so much, Aarti ji. Thank you so much, Rakhi. And we will be there next week again. And someday maybe we'll write a book about our 50 shows that we have done.
This is amazing. I learned something new every time. And you can tell by my comments, there are a lot of these conversations happening with all the different Hindu organizations, but there's something new learned every time. And there are those of us who think we know a little bit of our Indian history, but it just peels back so many layers of that onion to show how little we don't know, and how no matter how much we learn the facts or the actual real history, of ours, some organization, some new organization or group is bound to pop up to try to hijack that narrative, that truth of ours, and, redo it for their own political and monetary gain agenda. That's what it's all coming down to. That's why I'm purposely getting politically involved, because we have to get stronger. Let them take aims and shots at us. We will only get stronger.
Thank you so much, Arthi.
I really appreciate it. Utsada, we have a special music created just for this show by Decibels. And this is, I don't think you have heard this, but this is truly a unique tune that they created just for us. So as we shut down this session and I'll turn off all the videos, I will, the next 2 minutes, we will be playing the special music created for the 50th show by Decibels. Utsada, with that, thank you and namaste to everyone, Aarti ji, Rakhi ji, Vinod ji, Priya ji, and of course Utsada. Namaste and thank you. Please join us again next week. And before you go, please listen to this 2 minute music clip by Decibels, a special, special music just created for this show. Thank you.